Greetings, everyone. I have to tell you, it's just fabulous to see this many people and kindred spirits in one spot. So I'm thank you for having fun to have you all here. My name is Marty Gent. I'm Vice President of the Nova Scotia Humane Society. And now we're just over 20 years old, and the founding members and myself, that would be Beth Kent, Kate Wicker, Barry Crozier, and myself, we'd like to welcome you, and we're going to start the show in just a couple minutes. Beth Kent has been, she was first and foremost in the beginnings of our group. And Beth has, for more than 50 years, fought every battle she could for any animal that ever needed help. She has stood fast in promoting animal welfare and animal rights, and was always there, and still is, for any animal that calls on her. It is through the courtesy of and financial contributions from Beth that we've been able to pull this together, to have Derek and Steve come down for our talk and for the weekend. And I just think it was a brilliant idea, and I want to, for my part, I want to thank her very much for coming up with such a great scheme. Sadly, Beth is not well, and she's not able to join us today. So I really want to dedicate this visit to Nova Scotia and this talk this evening to Beth, and thank her again that she's always been there and she always will be. So I'm pretty sure that everybody in this room is well versed on the exploits of Esther and what she did for Derek and Steve. How she entered their life as the quote-unquote spayed mini pig, who wasn't spayed and wasn't a mini pig. She has grown in many ways, but right now physically to 600-something pounds. And when she entered their life, she changed their destiny, and I'd have to say all for the good. We're lucky that she entered their life because we get to have all the fun watching while they muck out the barn. So without further ado, because you're here to see the boys talk and not listen to me, I would like to welcome Derek and Steve, Esther's dads.
Oh, Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. My name's Derek, and this is my partner, Steve. We were just two normal guys, and our lives changed in some pretty incredible ways about 6 years ago. Actually, our lives changed in every way possible. I was a professional magician, and Steve was a real estate agent, and I came home one evening, and the house was particularly clean that day. There was music playing, the candles were lit, dinner was in the oven. I had just gotten home from a long day of shows, and I knew something was up. Our two dogs, they normally greet me at the door when I arrive home, but this particular evening, the two dogs were down the hallway, and their faces were glued to the French doors, and they were looking inside the office. I raced down the hallway, and there she was. There was this little 6-pound pig in the office, and she was sleeping in a cat carrier. I did not know that Esther was going to be there. So you see, Steve had brought her home without any sort of family consultation. Steve got a message on Facebook from a friend of a friend of a friend, as you do, and this particular friend said that she had a mini pig that was about 6 months old, and she was spayed, and she was no longer getting along with the family. This family had just had a new child that was brought into the world, and also they had a dog, and this pig was causing some hierarchy issues within the family, and they needed to find a new home. So Steve, of course, said yes, and he went and picked her up and brought her home. I was furious, to put it lightly. I painted the house in colorful language, things that I never knew that I could say and sling them together. Those all came out. You see, 8 months previous to this occasion, Steve had brought home a cat, unannounced, Dolores, and without any sort of family consultation, again, brought her home. I could not imagine sharing my square footage with anybody else. You see, we lived in a small house, about 1,000 square feet, and we had the house, two, three houses would fit in this room, including the yard. It was not that big of a setup. And we had a roommate, one of my girlfriends, Crystal, and her cat, Pudge, myself and Steve, our two dogs, Shelby and Reuben, and our two cats, Dolores and Finnegan. So we all lived in this small little house, and when I saw that we had to share more square footage, I knew I was upset, right? And also our roommate too. I was trying to keep things smooth with her, and we should have definitely included her on the family intake. she got along really well. Esther did with. Here's how big she was. You could fit two of her in a shoebox. She was about the size of a boot, if you will. And she made it really easy to get along with. I mean, as mad as I was mad at Steve, and I was not mad at her, you see. She didn't have any say in this. And the fact that she got along with our other family members made it particularly easy as well to keep her, or the thought of keeping her became easy. So that's our two dogs, Shelby and Reuben. They've since passed, and Finnegan has also passed. And so Dolores is still residing in the family. It was amazing to see Esther fit in with our family. I mean, Reuben put up the biggest fight of all, and Esther would seek his approval daily. It was really, really interesting to see the relationship start between the dogs and the cats and Esther.
You see, one of the reasons I couldn't tell Derek that Esther was coming home is because we lived in a town where she was illegal. And I had found that out pretty quickly in my research and trying to figure out what I was getting myself into. And Derek is a real rule follower. I'm more the ask permission or the beg forgiveness than ask permission type, and I knew he wouldn't go for it, knowing that we weren't supposed to have her in town. So after we had built that bridge, Derek was willing to accept Esther, and he kind of started to forgive me, not fully. We launched the task of trying to find a vet. I didn't want to find a vet in town because, again, I didn't know how it was going to work. Was I going to show up at the vet and he would, you know, turn us in, we would lose Esther. So we did some research and found a vet out of town, about 40 minutes away from where we lived. And it was about 3 weeks from when Esther arrived at home to when we finally booked that first vet appointment and said, okay, she's staying, you know, let's take her to the vet and figure out what we're dealing with. So that's when things took a real turn for us, because the first thing the vet said when he saw her was, Steve, I think you've got a problem on your hands here. And I said, no, Dr. Kirkham, don't worry, Derek's gonna be fine. And you know, he was talking about Esther's tail. You see, I knew nothing about pigs. Derek knew nothing about pigs when Esther arrived. And Esther has a cropped little tail. It's only about 3/4 of an inch long. And he said that's something that no breeder of pet pigs would ever do to one of their pot bellies or Julian pigs. So he was very confident that Esther was a commercial pig. The last thing that I needed to be going home and telling Derek at that point in time. So, you know, then of course became the discussion, well, my God, Dr. Kirkham, how big is she gonna get, right? We were told she was gonna be 70 pounds when she was full grown, which is about the size of a medium-sized dog. Pigs are really, really dense. So they weigh a lot, but they're not as big as you might think they would be. So, you know, a 70-pound pig was pretty small, very manageable. And when we started discussing at the vet's office, he goes, well, Steve, it you know, could be anywhere from 250 pounds to 800 pounds. You know, we have no idea. You know, if I was told that she was 6 months old, but based on that meeting, Dr. Kirkham said there's no way that she's 6 months old. He said, we're going to have to do a growth chart. And that's about the only way that we're going to be able to figure out, you know, how old she is and try to kind of plot on this graph as she's growing. And that might help give us a little bit of a better indicator of how big she was going to be. So I composed myself and got everything together and went home to tell Derek the news, kinda.
When Steve got home, he failed to disclose all of the information that the vet had shared with him. When he started with, well, I think she's gonna be a little bit bigger than we thought. Should have probably sat down at that moment. It turns out she's gonna be maybe 200 to 250 pounds. That's it. No problem. About the size of a, you know, again, the size of a medium-sized dog or the size of your typical pot-belly pig. So that was a surprise, of course, and I was worried, naturally, about the path that we could be on. But 200 pounds, that's not so bad, so we carried on. At this point, we had heard that you could house train pigs and that you could train them to use a litter box. So that's what we did. We started to train Esther to use a litter box. So she's about this big, and we got an appropriate size litter box that would be for a cat. And that worked for, about a week, right? And then she was standing in the litter box. She's in the right place, but she's peeing out the litter box. Or she would have two hooves in the litter box. You know, she's in the right location, but the business end is not. We had to buy a bigger litter box. And we bought a bigger litter box, a bigger container, a bigger tray. A bigger, you know, we started using unconventional things and eventually ended up using a kiddie pool, one of those typical blue pools, you know, that's very thin, the world's thinnest plastic. And we would fill that full of wood chips and we would, you know, we trained her to go to that and she would. And she would do that religiously. It was no problem. She picked it up. But half the time, she's only standing in it and she's going out the other end. We used a rainforest's worth of paper towel and newspaper during this time of training her. And we had this big crate that was about the size of a smart car, and that's basically, that was her naughty cage if she was being bad, or, you know, we'd try to train her the same way you would a dog, and they would have a cage to
time
go
out.
To, a timeout time. So we realized as she started to get bigger that, you know, probably litter training her in the house is not the best plan. So Esther had reached 250 pounds by Christmas. And that's about, we got her August, so September, October, November, December, January. Really scary time. She was just growing so fast. At the fastest point, she was growing over a pound a day. And that was, if we plotted...
The jig was up, Derek knew I wasn't.
Yeah, we plotted that out. We were like, oh my gosh, a pound a day for the next year. And I'm just doing the math, and oh my gosh. So we started training her to no longer use the litter box and to attempt to go outside. Initially, the thought was, well, we'll try to keep her inside as much as possible so the neighbors don't see her, we don't freak the neighbors out, because the neighbors are like there, and I mean, they're you can tell when the neighbor's in the washroom because their light's on. That's how
close
we are.
Would have been four houses in this room.
Like, yeah. So she grasped house training really well. I mean, it did take us some time to reverse the patterns that we had created with her initially, but once she grasped it, I mean, she went out religiously without our interaction. You see, she was so smart, she figured out how to open the doors. She would use her snout, she would lift the lever and pull back and open the door and let herself out. And she would let herself back in too when it was all finished. Pigs are so smart. They are one of the smartest creatures on this planet, next to elephants, chimpanzees, dolphins.
And humans.
Pigs are about as smart as a four-year-old toddler. They understand all emotions. They can have the same emotions that we can. They can have sadness, depression, happiness, joy. They can anticipate as well. Pigs can play video games too. They've in clinical studies, they have taught pigs to use their snout and use a joystick and follow the screen and legit play video games. They have also, as pigs, just they are so smart. They are only one of the only creatures that, when you use mirrors and food, they can navigate themselves around mirrors and find the food. They are connected in some pretty amazing ways, and it's sad because pigs have a bad rap. You know, they have a bad rap for being smelly, dirty, stinky, angry animals. That's what we hear. That's what we see on TV. That's the stories that we hear. But, you know, let me dispel a few of those myths. Number one, dirty. Sometimes, yeah. But they get dirty for a reason. You see, they roll in mud, or they wallow, it's called, in mud. If it's very hot outside, they need to stay cool, so they coat themselves in mud. Also, for sunscreen. You see, you and I have the privilege of putting on sunscreen where they don't. Their skin burns just like ours does. It blisters, and they can get all sorts of skin cancers, the same things that we can get, they can get. So they wallow in the mud to protect themselves from the sun. Another thing that they wallow in the mud from is if the bugs are bad. You know, mosquitoes are biting them, those horse flies taking little bits of you. They roll in mud, and then that way the mosquitoes and the bugs can't bite through the mud. So it's a response to what they are experiencing. A lot of people see pigs just as a product of their environment, where they're enclosed in sheds and they can't get outside, and it's a mess, right? It's a mess because they can't get outside. Pigs are one of the cleanest animals, hands down. They won't go to the bathroom where they sleep when given the chance to go outside. You see, the farm pigs at Happily Ever Esther, we almost never have to clean their stalls. They keep impeccably clean stalls. So, you know, people are typically, you know, when you see a pig, you typically see 25 pigs in a small room, and they are a mess. They're all cut up because they are suffering temporary insanity, and any species in that environment, they would go through that also. If you can't get away from one another and there's 25 of you crammed in a room, you're going to be mad. You're going to be cross. And so pigs, they bite, and usually the last thing to leave the scene of a fight is your tail. right? And so your tail gets bit or gets bit off. And so that's why they crop the tails. That's an industrialized farming practice. So rather than give the pigs more space, the ability to get away from each other, the ability to go outside and do something, get stimulated, the pigs all suffer insanity. They fight each other. They bite each other. They injure each other. So rather than give them what they need, they cut the tail off and they cut the teeth off and they put this ear trace tag in.
So the more time we spent with Esther and got to see all these crazy characteristics that Derek's describing, her intelligence and this personality and you know, Piggy Parade, one of the things Derek didn't talk about is they get scared. Pigs get afraid. So Esther would sleep in the living room at night, and if there was a loud noise or something startled her, she'd come barreling down the hallway and climb up into bed with us because they like to sleep in piles. They feel comfortable when they've got somebody touching them, which is why you'll often see her and Phil in our most recent photos. They're always touching. She loves it. She loves to have somebody against her. But the more we saw all these amazing characteristics from Esther, we kept coming back to that word our vet said, which is she's a commercial pig. You see, I had a wall up, as I think most people do. You know, companion animals are one thing, food animals are an entirely different thing. I remember even joking with a friend the first few weeks that we got Esther, where he said, "Oh, Steve, you'll never be able to eat bacon again." I said, "Jordan, don't be ridiculous. That's a different kind of pig." You know, all of a sudden I had that pig. So we couldn't get that out of our minds. And we kept seeing this amazing smiling face and then thinking about what we'd been told from the vet. And that made us want to know more. You know, all those, we'd spent our entire life trying not to know what went on in the animal agriculture industry, looking the other way when the trucks went by or ignoring graphic images that we saw on the internet. But Esther made that impossible. She made us want to know what her life could have been like. So we started watching documentaries. We started watching things like Veducated and Forks Over Knives and Food Inc. You know, all super easy to watch. Graphic images are not our thing. Super easy to watch, but full of crazy information. And the more we learned, the more we wanted to know, and the more mind-boggling it was, the environmental impacts, the health impacts, and of course the impacts to animals and the actual practices that are employed. You know, we hear the term humane meat all the time, right? It makes us feel comfortable about it. At the end of the day, there's no humane way to kill anything, you know, but we hear these things, they're marketing terms, and they make us feel good about participating in something that once we start to know and started to actually find out more, Derek and I didn't want anything to do with it. You know, the thought of Esther being in that life was just too much for us, and because of that, we at first said, well, we'll never eat pork again. You know, that was the first thing. We were actually cooking bacon on the stove, believe it or not. We had the dogs at Derek's feet. I was in the dining room and Esther was there as well, waiting for something to fall off the stove. And it was a real light bulb moment for both of us. You know, I'd been having thoughts a little bit and I know Derek had as well. But at that moment, we kind of made eye contact and I said, "Derek, I can't eat that." And he said the same thing. And that was it. So it started with pork products. We said, well, we can't eat pigs anymore. But again, the more we learned and the more we found out what was going on in the industry, it really didn't take us long to decide that we were going to give up animal products altogether. And we adopted what we call an Esther-approved lifestyle.
An Esther-approved lifestyle. So it's basically all plant-based eating. No meat, no dairy from animals, and no eggs. And then that goes from there, no fur, no leather, and you figure out ways. There is, you know what, we wish that we had changed sooner. That is what we, you know, that's what our wishes are. Somebody said, would you do it again? Yes, we would do it again, but we wish we would have done it sooner. And it's so easy. I mean, the transition, there are so many products on the shelf to help you transition away from animal agriculture into what we call the Esther approved lifestyle. There are amazing plant-based milks that are available. There are amazing substitute meats that are available. And right now, coming out in the US is it Beyond Meat? The cultured meat.
No,
the clean meat. Yeah, there we are. The clean meat. So the petri dish meat, where they are taking stem cells from an animal and they are growing meat in clean environments, and it has, you know, there's no animals that are slaughtered, and that's coming out. That's coming out now. So these things are all there to help us transition easily away from it. Because if you were to say to somebody, you know, do you want to abuse that animal? Of course, everybody's going to say no, right? But we're not used to seeing animals in the stores. They're all in packages. There's nothing left of that animal, so we're able to completely separate it. You know, leading an Esther-approved lifestyle is so easy. You know, there no doubt about it, there are struggles with change, as all change, there, you know, that it comes with the territory, but ultimately it is so easy. We created a Facebook page called Esther's Kitchen. And
that came after the first Facebook page.
Yeah, that came after the first Facebook page. I'm jumping a little ahead of myself here, but we created a Facebook page called Esther's Kitchen, where it's all plant-based eating, and we are able to showcase recipes that people might think can have animal products in it, but when it's made and they're consuming it, there are no animal products. It's completely Esther approved.
Yeah, it was about a year and a half, almost 2 years, by the time we decided to start our social media pages, and it took us that long to really wrap our heads around it. As Derek said, you know, learning to live an Esther-approved lifestyle was a learning curve for us. We were the last people, had you met us before Esther came around, that you would think would one day be giving talks about living an Esther-approved lifestyle. That just wasn't us. She made it impossible for us to look away anymore. And by the time we wrapped our heads all around that, we started this Facebook page with the intention just of updating our friends and family. You know, we finally had it together. Esther was settled. We were kind of, you know, on this new path, and we thought everything was sorted out. So this page was just meant to show our friends and family. We'd done a really good job of keeping Esther quiet, believe it or not. We didn't put her on our own social media pages. The neighbors knew we had her, but, you know, there was nothing more than that. I remember, you know, about 2.5 years in, a neighbor from four doors down came and knocked on the house one day and said, "Oh, my son says he saw a really big pig on your front yard, and is he crazy?" And she escaped the front yard. I got her back in about 2 minutes, but these kids spotted her. But even four doors up, they didn't know we had her. So this Facebook page was to show our friends and family what it was like to live with her. Derek's parents lived about 4.5 hours away. I have a ton of family that's over in Scotland. So it was for them. But somehow, her page went viral, and we went from nothing to 100,000 followers in 80 days. So we put these photos up, you know, just showing what we were doing on a daily basis. Like I said, Esther's hilarious. She's got so much personality. So those were the kinds of captions, and that was kind of the tone that we decided to take with the page. And really quickly, we started to get messages from people that were basically retelling our story. So they were saying, "Oh my God, I had no idea, you know, that pigs were so smart or so clever or, you know, so pretty, whatever. I'm never going to eat bacon again, or I'm never going to eat pork again." And that's when Derek and I realized that there was something to just getting to know her and just falling in love with her. So we decided we weren't going to do any direct vegan messaging. We weren't going to do anything that was, you know, potentially causing arguments on the page, because we noticed when somebody would say, "I'm never going to eat bacon anymore," somebody that was a vegan would jump on the page and say, "Well, what about cows and chickens? And, you know, you're being such a hypocrite if you're going to still eat cows and chickens." It would start fights. And that person that had their wheels turning, you know, that was thinking about something, all of a sudden felt backed into a corner, and they would disappear. We didn't know if they stuck with it, if they gave up pork, or if we were able to help them take the next step, because they would get defensive or they would feel attacked and they would leave the situation. So we made a really conscious effort to remove any direct vegan messaging. We actually, to this day, believe it or not, have to ban and remove more vegans from Esther's page than anybody else because of that. Because, to be honest, vegans get it. You know, vegans understand the message. They understand why we do what we do. We're not here for vegans. Esther the Wonder Pig does not exist to make the whole vegan world happy. We exist and do what we do to get through to people that are like we were 6 years ago. you know? And we can't do that if people feel attacked. So we're incredibly cautious about keeping funny, lighthearted images with funny and relatable captions so that people are falling in love with her as a character and as an individual. And when they go to the grocery store, all of a sudden, instead of seeing bacon, they see Esther. Instead of seeing pork chops, they think of Esther. That's kind of what gets the wheels turning. And as soon as they say something like, oh, I'm never gonna eat pork again, it provides us with an opportunity to say, well, hey, you should check out Esther's kitchen. You know, it's a whole bunch of Esther-approved recipes. You know, we don't even use the word vegan, right? We just say, oh, Esther-approved recipes, you're gonna love it, go check it out. So it's a really nice, gentle way to encourage people to look at things that they may otherwise not look at. They've got a misconception around the word vegan, right? I think a lot of people can admit that there are some very strong misconceptions about what it means to be a vegan. And we spend a lot of time trying to correct those when people are confused, so.
Once the Facebook page went up and we were doing about 6 posts a day, we started to get a lot of messages were coming in. Private messages, emails, telephone calls. On the uptick of when it went viral, we were getting about 8,000 emails a day. That's a real number. And of those 8,000 messages, it seemed like, you know, most of them were people saying, I had no idea pigs were so smart. I had no idea that pigs smelled like maple syrup. I had no idea that pigs were so clean. And basically, people were retelling our story back to us about them learning about pigs. And so we started to call those stories the Esther Effect stories. One of the Esther Effect stories that came in, I mean, there are literally thousands of them, and this is just a couple of the notable ones. Just wanted to share my story today. We go to Whole Foods for lunch here in the UK, ordered our lunch. I can't even speak what I ordered, but I looked at my husband with tears in my eyes and spoke your name. I couldn't do it. We gave our plates back and ordered something else. Esther, you have made 2 more changes. Yeah. Thank you. That's it. Every day I look at your posts of Esther. Thank you so much for the work you do to share them. It works. I used to like bacon and ham and especially pulled pork, but now after falling in love with Esther and looking into those intelligent, kind eyes, I think of her and actually get physically ill seeing any kind of porcine product. My entire family is pork-free now. The everyday exposure to your photos and great commentary are working, even for an old-fashioned doctor like me. These stories, there are thousands of them. And another thing that people started to write in, we've heard from educators and doctors and people that deal with dementia patients and people that have mental health issues. And we learned that doctors and educators are using Esther's daily content as an icebreaker, or maybe at a nursing home. You know, for activities. Everybody sits around and they watch pictures of Esther and stuff that's going on at the farm. People have connected in a really incredible way.
We even had a professor write once. He'd said he'd spent his entire professional life studying pigs and he had never seen such a large pig go up or down a flight of stairs. You know, so just little things like that. And our opportunity to be able to show people a side of these animals that they haven't seen before. Has been a really, really unbelievable experience. So the result of all of this attention that we were getting, as Derek said, the page went viral, the media attention was unbelievable, the messages coming in, our attempts to show our friends and family what was going on and keep Esther and the attention from Esther away from us had failed miserably. So we were terrified again that the town was gonna come knocking. You know, we'd made it for over 2 years without ever having a phone call from the town. And we thought that this was going to be the end of it. We lived in fear of a white van showing up one day, saying they were taking Esther and she was out of there. So we knew that we needed to move. And in the early days of having Esther, we have to admit that there was a time where we weren't sure if we were going to be able to do it, if we were going to be able to keep her and see it through. I would have a day where I was just in hysteric sobbing because I thought she was going to destroy the house, or because I'd go out to do something thinking I was going to prove to Derek what a good girl she was, you know, and Derek, everything's fine, and I'd leave her out of her crate and go grocery shopping or something. and came home to a gallon of vegetable oil spread all over the house, you know, half an hour before Derek came home from a magic show. And so we weren't sure whether we were going to do it and or if we could do it. And we found out that there were places called farm sanctuaries. We'd never heard of a farm sanctuary before that point. And it was just because we were looking for potential homes. If we had to get rid of her, where was she going to go? And we knew that, you know, most of the options for a pig like Esther were not suitable at all. We found these places called sanctuaries, but we found out that they were, for the most part, struggling for funding, or they were struggling for volunteers. Nobody knew who they were or where they were. And so with all of this attention falling on us and us realizing that we needed to move, and we knew we were going to move to the country, we thought, well, why not start our own sanctuary? You know, we've got all of these people that are now expressing an interest in us and what we're doing and Esther, that why not, you know, seize that opportunity to take it to the next level and actually open our own farm sanctuary. And so we decided that we would start a crowdfunding campaign. So we had no idea how to do a crowdfunding campaign. We knew nothing about what was going to happen.
We asked Esther's page, the fans on Esther's page, what they thought about the idea of us opening a farm sanctuary. And there was a resounding yes. You know, people were pushing us to the start line. And we asked for probably a month, right? Because we were visiting sanctuaries online and trying to figure out what plan of action we were going to
take. Keep in mind, this is 4 months after the page started. So things happened ridiculously fast. The page started December 4th. This was by, you know, April and May. We started to talk about this potentially crowdfunding and moving to a sanctuary. So it was, you know, felt like days.
Yeah, and the sanctuaries that we were looking at leaving Esther, they weren't anywhere that we were comfortable leaving Esther with. They didn't have concrete plans, they didn't have concrete volunteers. Some places were operating on love alone, and although love is great, it doesn't pay the bills. So we were concerned about where we were going to leave her, if that was what we were going to come to. And Stephen and I both had these independent thoughts, and we would try to raise each other up in our lowest points. You know, he didn't want me to see him cry, vice versa, about the situation. So if he was having a really bad day, I'd be like, oh, it's all good, I got it, you know, it's all good, I'll do the cleaning, and vice versa. If I was having a bad day, he would certainly pick up double duty. So Esther's audience said, yes, let's do it. Let's go start a crowdfunding campaign. So we started a crowdfunding campaign with Indiegogo, and we raised $440,000 in 60 days. And we took that money and we went and put a really good down payment on a farm, Cedarbrook Farm, and that is now Happily Ever Esther Farm Sanctuary, where we rescue abused and abandoned farmed animals.
Slide.
Skip. Yeah. This is the Esther stepping off the trailer for the first time.
We moved to the farm in November of 2014. So again, less than a year from when the Facebook page started. The campaign ended, was it July 1st?
That's right.
Right? Campaign ended July 1st. And in November, we closed on that farm. So Esther arrived the day after we took possession. There were no fences. So we spent the first day there building fences somewhere that we could at least get Esther off the trailer and have somewhere to go. And it was a mad dash to get that farm prepared. It hadn't been used as a farm for almost 25 years. We're actually the third family to own it. So it was a gorgeous property, but it was in terrible, terrible need of some loving attention. So we immediately got to work. We had a workday planned. It was one of the perks from the crowdfunding campaign, but that workday wasn't until the following spring. So for that entire winter, it was Derek, myself, and a few of our close friends and family would come down and would work like maniacs trying to prepare this farm. We also had a horse and a donkey arriving a month after we arrived at the farm. We'd agreed to take those animals before we even moved to the farm. That's a long story. So it's in the book, though. You could read the book. it's a long story how we ended up with BJ and Escalade. But they arrived a month later, and a month after them, we had pigs arriving. It just, as soon as we hit the ground, we were running, and things were frantic trying to prepare for opening day a few months later.
So the next video that's here, I remember when we lived in Georgetown, our small house, walking Esther. we would put this harness on her. She's 400 pounds, by the way.
Late at night.
And the harness was made out of seat belts, and it was riveted together. And it had two lanyards on it, so he would hold on to one side, and I would hold on to the other side. And we would be water skied along. Cars would stop on the roadway, reverse up the reverse and go, is that a pig? And this next moment here, I had imagined this moment for a real long time, and that was a space for Esther to run. We only had this small backyard, and she couldn't really get going full steam because it's too short of a distance. So this next video here was like icing on the cake here. I waited forever for this moment. And as did she. I know that she really enjoyed that too. Yeah. So people came running from all corners of the globe to help us clean up this little piece of paradise. It's called Cedarbrook Farms. There's a river that runs through it. There's a small pond. And there's no road access. You can't see the farm from the road. It's a really long driveway. None of the fields corner on any roads. And it was a little piece of paradise. The farm was quite run down. There were collections of stuff everywhere. The garage was full of stuff that we had no idea what it did, how to run it, if it ran.
We still only know how to use about half of it.
Yeah. So people came running from all over the place just to help us, shore up fencing, help us clean up the pastures. And it was a remarkable experience. We had people from French Polynesia, we had people from Australia, basically every country you can imagine.
There was just under 7,500 people contributed to the campaign to get us to the sanctuary from 44 different countries. It was literally a worldwide endeavor to get us there. It was unbelievable.
And one of the perks, so if you donated during the campaign, we had some what we called perks, and it was to try to motivate people to donate again. So we would come up with some creative ideas during the campaign, and you would put them out there. You know, for $5, you can get a ringtone of, you know, Esther snorting, or, so just something that just to try to get $5 more in the game. And so we created all these little perks, and some of the perks were quite large. You could have your name on a stall in the barn. You could have your name on Esther's favorite sleeping place, benches and picnic tables around the farm. Fruit trees, vegetable gardens, all that stuff could have naming rights to it. So we tried to come up with fun and exciting ways to motivate people to put more skin in the game.
You'll notice though those perks were also things that were very useful to us at the farm. So there's always a method to our madness, and so while we want people to feel engaged and feel like part of it, the idea of somebody planting a tree, especially a fruit tree at the farm, right? They feel amazing because they know they've got a part of something that they put on that farm, but that tree is going to feed animals on our farm for years and years and years. So the perks and the stuff that we tried to pick for the campaign were all things that we knew the farm needed, and that we knew people would be enthusiastic about supporting and being a part of. So we try to be as creative as we possibly can with stuff like that to get people excited in something that, let's be honest, not a whole lot of people are excited about. So,
yeah, the momentum is quite strong, and when we think it's going to slow down, it speeds up, and it's still rolling, and it is so exciting to cultivate this much excitement for farmed animals, because up to this point, let's be honest, people aren't really stoked about a farm pig or about a cow or a chicken, but getting people the opportunity to meet these animals, that was the exciting part, where people were involved online, and they, you know, if they contributed to the campaign and then next year they've planned a trip to come to Happily Ever Esther Farm to help clean up a bit, take a tour, and get a chance to meet some of the residents. If there's one thing that I've learned more than anything about this whole endeavor is that the way that we are able to save the most amount of animals is by getting people like you guys to meet them. And it's an amazing experience when you see somebody meet a chicken and they're crouched down on the floor with this chicken, and you can just see the magic is You can see the sparkle in the eyes. You know, most people have never met a chicken or a cow or a pig outside of a grocery store. And the way that we are able to save the most amount of animals is by getting people to meet them and then choosing not to eat them.
It's about building personal relationships. And the best possible way to do that is like Derek said, for people to come and to get to meet and see these animals in a very different way. And that's why we created Happily Ever Esther.
It's, video. Oh yes, we're gonna play a short video here for you about where we are today. I hope this will play. Yeah.
So it's pretty crazy to look back and think about everything that's happened in what really has been a tremendously short amount of time. And, you know, we ask ourselves all the time, how, you know, how has this happened, and how have we been able to do so much? And I believe with every fiber of my being, the key to Esther the Wonder Pig and everything that we have achieved is the fact that we treat everybody with kindness. Everything that Esther does is rooted in kindness and being kind to people and being understanding to people, even if they're not at the same position in their life that you are. You know, we didn't change overnight. It took us a couple of months to figure things out, even with Esther at our feet. We've got members of our family, believe it or not, that still do not lead an Esther-approved lifestyle. But, you know, getting fed up and giving up on them and not having faith in being able to change and being able to change anybody isn't going to help anything. We remain positive, and if we can change, then anybody can change. And the only way that you're going to get through them is to make people feel supported, make them feel appreciated. You know, when those people write to say, I'm never going to eat pork again, you know, the first thing we say is, unbelievable, congratulations, good for you. You know, it's the best decision you're ever going to make. You know, go to Esther's Kitchen, check out some unbelievable Esther-approved recipes. It is nothing but support and positivity. You know, the vast majority of our following is not vegan, and we understand that. We know that it's going to take some time to get there. But based on the messages that we've heard, people like ourselves, some of the messages that you saw tonight, we should all be incredibly optimistic about what is possible and what we can do. And the world is heading in the right direction. Things are changing incredibly fast. The only way to keep that momentum going is to be kind, support people, support your friends, support your family, and be a kind person to everybody that you come across. That's about the best possible advice that we as Esther the Wonder Pig can give you.
Thank you. Lead by example. If your friends around you seeing you struggle with change, they will think that they will struggle with change too, and it's unlikely that they will join in with you. If you make it seem easy and if you make it seem achievable and you celebrate small steps, people will join on with you. Lead by positive example. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you.
We want to thank the organizers for this event. We want to thank Tamara and Katie and Marnie and Gail and Barry. They made sure that our room was ready for us, and they made sure that we got here on time, and they made sure all the arrangements were perfect. So thank you very much for their contribution.
Yes.
Thank you. So we're going to take some questions. We're going to do a question and answer period, and we've got some moderators here going to run around with microphones. And if you have a question, just put your hand up in the air and shout bingo. Oh, there we are.
Thank you. Hi, thanks so much for being here. I'm wondering about the learning curve of going from being pet parents to dogs and cats to being pet parents to farm animals. How did you learn?
It was a wild learning curve.
It was
a lot of those
trial.
Books for dummies, right? We've got horses for dummies and cows for dummies and pigs for
chickens,
dummies.
Chickens, homesteading for dummies. There's quite a yellow library in my office. But leading by example, and we're surrounded by people that want us to succeed. We have vets and you know, vet students and other sanctuary owners as well that will help us if we have a question.
Yeah, we've been incredibly fortunate because of the reach that we have online and the contacts that we've made online, that we've been able to get in touch with some of the, you know, foremost specialists and, you know, pig specialists, for example, Esther's health situation that we've been dealing with this past year. We've been in touch with, you know, countless university hospitals and doctors and professors and other sanctuary founders. You know, Susie Costin at Farm Sanctuary, for example, has been unbelievable for us. She is an encyclopedia when it comes to knowledge about farmed animals. And Susie is incredibly fast to take our call, which is amazing. We're unbelievably grateful to have access to the people that we have access to. And that actually, I do this all the time. I ramble, by the way, because now this is leading me to the we know that we have access to stuff that a lot of other people may not be able to. You know, it's hard to get information on pigs. It's hard to get information on some of these animals, especially as they're advancing in age, because people just don't know. You know, Esther being sick this year, I'm sure many of you know about the scanner situation. You know, she's not that big, and you know, again, she's 600 pounds, but to think that there was no equipment available that would be able to tell us what was wrong was mind-boggling for us. And we had the CFIA on board. They were gonna work with us to deal with a different quarantine situation. And we had people bending over backwards to allow us to go to New York. And there were still a lot of hurdles that we had to jump through. But we were getting people paying attention in a way that, you know, had she not been Esther the Wonder Pig, the answer might have just been no. Which isn't cool. So that's why we got the scanner. And that's why we fought so hard for the scanner, so that people can get access to that information so much easier. Because it can be hard, and it's terrifying when you don't have the answer. And yeah, we're very, very lucky that we've had so much support in getting answers when we need them. So, sorry, it was a really long answer. Derek can answer the next one.
Yeah.
Hello, gentlemen. I just wanted to ask, with your wonderful animals, all that you care about, how destructive can a pig be in a home?
Oh my goodness, collateral damage is a word that we use a lot. And you can't be attached to stuff. I mean, you can't take it with you. And there is nothing in the house that is too heavy for Esther to flip over. And if you were to bolt something down to the floor would become the weakest link and would be pulled up. So it doesn't matter. You know, when Esther first came into our lives and she discovered how to open up cupboards in the kitchen, that was a self-discovery. We had to learn that we can't use conventional kitchens anymore. All the under cabinetry is empty. You can't have anything in the freezer that's down below because she can open that right up. If it's bolted down or tied down or taped shut or a little latch on it, it does not matter when you're 600 pounds.
Most of the problems she caused, though, were our fault. It was us learning as we went. Like Derek said, she would become destructive and damage the freezer if she knew there was food in there. You know, she knows there's no food in there. She hasn't touched the freezer in years. It was a learning curve, you know, to figure out what ticked for her. You know, on a regular daily basis, I mean, Esther is not a damaging animal. You know, she doesn't walk in and just randomly flip things over for no purpose. You know, she's, believe it or not, fairly gentle when she walks. She doesn't scratch the floors or stuff like that. You know, she's heavy, so she's hard on the couch occasionally. But it's well-built Canadian furniture.
That's
and
right,
it holds
that's
up
right.
pretty well.
That's right.
So, solid maple. But she's never intentionally destructive. The thing that, you know, causes damage is because she's so clever, right? Wanting to open that freezer, wanting to open cupboard doors, knowing that there's, you know, maybe a chip or something under the sofa, and rather than lying like a dog to try and scratch it, she's just gonna move the damn sofa. So that was the biggest thing. She doesn't mean to be, but she has the ability to be fiercely destructive because they're unbelievably strong. We were both sitting on the couch one day and it was a Cheerio. Remember, we ended up finding it was a Cheerio under the couch, but she lifted the love seat with us on it. And she came out from the end, and next thing we know, we're 2 feet in the air and she's getting a Cheerio from under the couch. So she forces us to keep a phenomenally clean house.
They're no more destructive than a child, you know, let's be honest. If you don't structure a child's time, they will structure it for you. Yeah. So a bored pig can be a problematic pig. Same way it goes with children, right? You leave stuff out and they get into it, and they draw all over everything. You know, if you don't structure their time, they will do it for you. Mm-hmm. Good question. So basically everything.
I have to ask this question. Who would you like to play Esther in a movie?
Susan Sarandon.
I just have to tell you that Alec Baldwin said he would love to do it.
Hilarious. That's so funny.
Susan Sarandon.
Well, who played the Devil Wears Prada? She's pretty good, too.
Meryl Streep.
Meryl Streep, yeah. We want to, if she's available.
Not for Esther. She's not suited for Esther.
To play my character.
Yeah, Meryl.
Hello.
Hello. How many animals do you have at the farm now?
Ooh, lots.
Yeah, there are 68 animals now, and 23 of which are pigs.
And that does not include the house residents.
That's right, yeah, that does not include Esther and Phil and Dolores.
Right.
Yes, and that includes Cornelius. Yes, Cornelius is moved
Cornelius
in.
Is a gray area. I'm going to be challenging the sanctuary for, what's the word?
Well, I mean, ownership is
parents.
The wrong word
no, no,
to
no.
use.
No, 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 custody. I'm going to be challenging the sanctuary for custody because Cornelius spends all of his time with me. But technically, yeah, he is a sanctuary resident. Don't tell him that, though.
We're upset. we have rabbits, chickens, peacocks, pigs, goats, sheep, cows, horse, donkey, and humans.
Yeah. An alpaca soon, I hope.
An alpaca.
No. We're gonna house alpaca.
So. At the sanctuary, because there's so much that goes on between Esther the Wonder Pig and Happily Ever After Farm Sanctuary, we've had to draw a line, and Steve now manages Esther the Wonder Pig, and I manage Happily Ever After Farm Sanctuary, because there's just so much stuff that goes on. So that's the line.
Divide and conquer.
That's right.
Thanks. Hello.
Hello.
I want to thank you for coming here and doing such a great presentation between the two of you. It's fabulous.
Oh, thank you so much.
That's the first thing. I want to offer a tool to anybody here and yourselves. It's written in the last 2 years by Mathieu Picard, A Plea for the Animals. It's a book in the library here. It's an amazing book, and it's a powerful tool. I'd like to offer it to you and all your friends. I'd like to ask, what kind of animal is Cornelius?
Cornelius? Do you mean literally, or what does he like to spend time with?
Literally, I'm sorry, he's a turkey.
He's a heritage breed turkey.
That is that I love dogs, particularly Nova Scotia retrievers.
Yes.
What do you feed them if you have chosen a vegan existence?
Absolutely.
And they are carnivores?
That's an amazing question.
How do you
question.
Deal with that? Because I want to get a dog, and yep. I'm groping with this.
That's an amazing question. We struggled with the same thing, and we weren't really sure what to do, but we have since found that there are quite a number, actually, of Esther-approved dog foods that are incredibly good for them. We had Shelby and Ruben, as you know. Shelby was 18, almost 19 when she passed. She had been on an Esther-approved diet for the last 5 years of her life, as had Ruben. They were both incredibly healthy, incredibly happy, and Phil, our newest dog, he is also on a plant-based diet, so he's doing incredibly well. Even the vets have been shocked. Phil has got amazing muscle tone, he's gained weight, he was super underweight when we first got him, he's a really high-stress dog. He's got separation anxiety issues, but he's gained weight, he's super healthy. We cannot say the same about cats, unfortunately. We do not know enough and haven't been able to find out enough about plant-based foods for cats. I do understand there are a few out. There's been huge progress there from what I know. I just don't know enough of the actual details to be able to implement it at our house. But we very confidently feed our dogs, and always will, plant-based food for sure.
It's called Natural Balance, and it's a brand name of food. And Natural Balance makes, you know, 30 different kinds of food, food that's got, you know, chicken, lamb, and et cetera, all the way down. Then they have a vegan bag, and it says vegetarian, but it also says vegan on it, and there are no animal fillers in it. It's been a wonderful thing. I mean, we have a responsibility to look after the animals that are in our care and provide for them what it is that they need. And we were able to find enough evidence to surround feeding dogs a vegan diet and having them live a very healthy life. You know, they're getting proteins from plants, the same plants that cows eat and grow big, right? They're eating plants, they're getting protein from plants, and they're growing enormous. So there are plant proteins that are suitable for dogs. And another brand of food that was available in Canada is called Bee Dog. and it's they've lost their distribution or something, and it's only available. It's only available in the States now. Natural Balance you can find at any major pet food retailer, and they also make a soft canned food. It's a vegan food that you can, you know, spice up somebody's life if they're if they need a special meal.
Thank you. Natural Balance.
Yes.
And also, it's clear that your message is kindness and care. That comes across 100%. That's what we want in this world.
Absolutely.
And I have to thank you for that. And the last thing is, now, last but not least, by George Bernard Shaw, be kind to animals, don't eat them.
Yes.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming, and thank you for all that you do. I'm just wondering, you must have a lot of people asking you to rescue animals or take them to the sanctuary, and how do you decide what animals you actually get to take?
I'm not allowed to see those emails. I have a problem.
So. There's a reason that we have divided and conquered. It's a difficult road for sure. And one of the, you know, how do we decide who we're going to take? How do we decide who we're going to help? Well, it really is in the moment. You know, it has a lot to do with the current financial standings with the farm. Can we support that extra resident coming in? Do we have adequate shelter? You know, we live in Canada. We need to provide, heated water so it doesn't freeze. We need to make sure that they've got windbreaks, and we need to make sure that we have adequate straw and adequate feed for the winter. So all those things have to make sure that they line up. And as well, do they have a herd that we think that they can go into? Because herd management is a very careful balance. So we have to make sure that we have a home for them within a herd, and as well, if we think that it's going to upset the welfare of our current residents, then the answer is no. We have a responsibility for the animals that are in our care, not for anybody else. It's the ones that we have on the property, the ones that call Happily Ever Esther home. I think the biggest realization is that we can't save them all. We just never will be able to. The numbers are against us. There are over 100 billion land animals in intensive confinement and captivity in North America alone. If we were even to take 1% of that, we would not be able to find homes for even 1% of those animals. You know, 1% of 100 billion is a lot. And if we look at all the animals that are in sanctuaries, it doesn't even come close to putting a dent in that. So education is key. We need to keep putting out education so that people understand all that there is about farmed animals, and if they're contributing to the, you know, if they are contributing to the demise of that animal in a, you know, an industrial farm situation.
One of the other things we've done too is our intention is not to fill our farm. So we've taken a real, you know, hardline stance on people ask all the time, you know, how many animals can your farm hold? Well, that doesn't matter, because hopefully we don't get there. Our objective is to find a home first and foremost. The very first thing that Derek does when an animal request comes in is we try to figure out what the problem is. Why do they need to rehome that animal? Is it a problem that can be solved or that we can help them with? And if not, then we try to find them another home. And we put our page, Esther's Army is one of the other social media pages that we have. That page was created initially to be kind of our fundraising base when we did that first crowdfunding campaign. So rather than completely flood Esther the Wonder Pig's page with fundraising posts, we had a dedicated group of people that we knew were very dedicated to what we were doing, and they came over to Esther's Army, and we would send instructions to that page and say, okay, crew, here's what we need you to do today. You know, blast this meme out, or, you know, go onto these pages and put it in the comment feeds, whatever it may be. That's what we used Esther's Army for. Once that crowdfunding campaign was done, it became our rehoming and sanctuary sharing site and all that sort of stuff. So we will spotlight other sanctuaries around the world. We will spotlight rescue requests because, again, of our online reach. We get requests, and Derek is getting requests from, you know, a little girl down in Mexico. I remember that a couple years ago. This little girl had run away from home with her pig because her parents wanted to send it to market, and she didn't want them to do it. And she was living in the jungle with this pig and would go into school every day and would send messages to Derek trying to get help, and then she would go back and sleep in the jungle with this pig. It was gut-wrenching. And those are the kinds of situations that no matter how much we want to help in Campbellville, Ontario, we can't. So Esther's Army has become incredibly valuable for that. We use it to rehome, what was almost 400 and something animals last year.
Yeah.
Animals that people wanted to come to our sanctuary or somebody else's, we were able to find private homes, therefore keeping them out of sanctuary so that they have room for, you know, a proper emergency. An animal that really does have nowhere else to go, then the sanctuaries have space for them.
The other quick thing I wanted to ask that kind of segues is, you've had so much happen so quickly. Are you concerned at all about your momentum stopping, or do you have a lot of worry about that? I mean, it yes. seems like there's a lot of people on board with this.
Yeah, it's definitely a worry. If we said that it wasn't, we would be lying. I mean, it's our job to make sure that we keep the momentum going, that we set up systems and protocols within the foundation, within Happily Ever Esther, that will perpetually just make sure that they are okay without us. It's our job to make sure we set it up so that it will operate without us. Mm-hmm. So we create fundraising campaigns that have a backbone to it that can be replicated the next year without us. And a succession plan, a clear succession plan that allows us to retire or, close Happily Ever Esther Farm Sanctuary when all of the residents have passed away through, natural causes. So
that's not the plan, by the
no,
way. Closing
no, no.
Happily Ever Esther is not the plan.
We try to get other sanctuaries to start thinking about their succession plans, because a lot of them do not have succession plans. They have several hundred animals all under their care, and they don't have a plan to retire. And it's scary, because those 200 or 300 animals, whoever is part of that family, we are not going to be able to find one single home for those animals. They are going to go 200 different ways. Your family will be broken up. It's your job as a sanctuary owner to create a succession plan so that your family stays together.
Yep.
Thank you. I hope that answered your question. Yeah.
Hi.
Hello.
I was wondering, what's your personal take on Petri dish meat? Once it becomes available for us to have in our homes.
Absolutely. This is such a hot topic in the vegan community, right? The best possible way, I think I rationalize it anyway, is I think, I know animals can't speak, but if we'd like to think of what would they say if they could speak, right? And I think if you were to ask any pig, cow, or chicken if they would be okay providing a biopsy or a needle injection versus the alternative, I think every single chicken, cow, and pig in the world would line up to provide you with a biopsy versus the alternative. So, is it perfect? No, absolutely not. And hopefully it's not something that, just replaces meat now. We'd like to phase that out, but it's an amazing alternative for the interim. It's an amazing transitional food, for people even like Derek and I. We were all about, Gardein and Field Roast and all of these faux meats. We were all about them as we went vegan, and we still do use them fairly regularly, so I'm sure there will be a place for them.
Clean meat's not created for vegans. We have to understand that. It's created for carnivores. We have an environmental disaster happening when you raise 100 billion animals and you have to grow food for them, you have to clear land and grow food for them, and then you got to figure out what to do with all their poop, right? That's some big world problems.
Yep.
So if we can eliminate them, if we can quantify it, and this is certainly quantifiable, it's two thumbs up. It's an amazing thing, and we have to encourage the people around us to try it. Is it for me? Like, am I going to run out the second that it's available? Probably not. I don't eat animal flesh, and that's what it is. So it's not for me. It's not for vegans, but for carnivores that are, I would absolutely be trying to get them on board to try it. Quantifiable results, and this is for sure one of them that is hands down, a handful of animals versus 100 billion. The math is so simple on that one. Vegans should be jumping up and down with joy.
Thank you. One more quick question. How has your stay in Halifax been so far?
Oh my God, I love the East Coast.
Yeah,
I love the East Coast. I play the bagpipes. So, yeah.
Sorry to hear that. Yeah.
A number of times. Love-hate thing, I know. So, yeah, I've been out here a number of times. And Halifax, it's so laid back. Ontario, well, compared to Ontario anyway, I don't know how many of you guys have been out or spent a lot of time in Ontario, but the GTA in particular is a rat race. It is just constant. The people on the East Coast are just so friendly and so much more Esther-like.
The pace is a lot slower here too, which is refreshing.
Yeah, I love it. Absolutely love it.
Another thought came into my mind about the clean meat. That's kind of, you know, it's kind of relevant. With all of our stays at the hospital with Esther, we had a person within the hospital, within the university, tell us that they are starting now to recommend. They've changed the curriculum, number one, and they are starting to recommend the folks that are in vet school to care for large animal for herd management. They are trying to curb them away from herd management. They say that in 30 years, this is the succession plan, in 30 years there will be no need for large animal herd vets, and that they are starting to curb that curriculum because this clean meat is going to absolutely squash huge animal agriculture. It is, you know, when it's coming from at the top down, we know that change is happening.
That's actually from the American Veterinary Association or something. So this was at a conference of all of the American and Canadian veterinary schools. That's where they were told, these people advised all of these schools that they should be telling students that it is no longer a viable career for students that are starting vet school now.
Yeah, the plant-based eggs is going to squash the egg industry. The petri dish meat is going to squash the industrial chicken houses. And it's same with beef. You know, it's the petri dish meat is absolutely going to squash that. And then we're going to have all this land to grow food for humans.
Hello.
Can you tell us how Esther is feeling?
Yes, Esther.
She's been great. She recovered beautifully from the previous surgery she had. She had those lumpectomies, so the four lumps were removed. She did beautifully well with that, and she's actually going in for her spay surgery
on November the 4th. She goes into the hospital on the 4th, and surgery is on the 6th. They've got to fast her for 36 hours, so we're doing it in the hospital because she's going to be so mad. So we'll be at the hospital for a couple of days before that surgery, and this is the spay is preventative, so this will drastically reduce the chances of either mammary or uterine tumors coming back.
And again, this is all comes back to us being misled in the beginning. We were told when we got her she was spayed. You know, we know she should have been spayed when she was young. She has a scar on her belly that they say is probably from an umbilical hernia, but it was consistent with a spay. It was one of those things, hindsight's 20/20. You know, it should have been done when she was a baby, and anybody that happens to have a pig in your family, it is definitely something to be aware of, for sure.
They have an app for that. You can track.
Lady days,
you can
oh
track,
my God.
Yeah, we never imagine having to track. Every 28 days, an email comes in and goes, oh, by the way, Esther needs some more sleep, or you just have to, you know, be on your toes.
Get out of her way.
You got to have your running shoes always on.
Derek and I thought we would never have to deal with that as a couple. It would be something that we would have to be aware of and tracking. But let me tell you, she makes us very aware. But all jokes aside, it's a serious health risk. Because she's not breeding, she basically was born to be a baby factory, remember, right? She's the same type of pig that we use in Canada as breeding sows. So she would have had litter after litter after litter. And usually for about 3 years, they're in that system. So the fact that she's not having babies and remained intact is most likely what resulted in the mammary tumors that we had. So it's just because she's not having babies that she's prone, which is why we want to get her spayed and hopefully never have to deal with that again.
We could take one more question.
Who told you that? Oh, we've been told.
I didn't come up with these ideas on my own.
Hi. I just wanted to start off by saying thank you. I'm in the veterinary industry, and the scanner is just phenomenal. It's so nice to be able to send animals. You know, I live in PEI, so we have the ABC. It was so nice to have that option that's not the state's. Yes. So thank you for that.
Of course, thank you.
And I'm sorry that my last question is really lighthearted, but I just wanted to know, did Corno just naturally gravitate to you, or did you have to bribe him?
Oh, no. Corno blew my mind.
He had humans already.
Yeah, he came from a home with humans. It was a senior couple that had him, and they always had him as a pet, but the city kind of grew around them, and bylaws changed, and they had to get rid of him. So he was always used to having human companions, and when he came to us, at first he just kind of hung around the front of the barn, right? It was a couple of weeks before he started coming and following us from the barn back to the house, and then he would sit on the deck while we were in the house, and he arrived over the summer, and I didn't bring him in the house until like October or November.
Well,
he had
2 months of quarantine, right?
Yeah.
Any new animal that comes onto the property, they go into quarantine to clear any bugs or issues that they have, that we don't want them contaminating any of the other residents. So Corno had some intestinal bugs that we were working on, coccidia. Mm. And so that took almost 2 months to clear up. And
yeah.
Coccidia is transferred in the fecal matter. And so if you have a bird with coccidia and they're going around the property and pooping all over the place, other birds can pick it up then, or humans can walk on it and bring it into the barn and other animals can catch it. So the quarantine period, after 2 months, he came out of that barn, yeah. And he was like, I'm going to the house.
Yeah, he came to the back deck, but I wouldn't let him in. We had Andrea, who works at the farm. I shouldn't say we have. Andrea's still at the farm. And Andrea would come every night to get Cornelius to take him to the barn, and you wouldn't believe the fight that he would put up. He would start yelling at her when she was 20 feet away, and Andrea, when she finally got him off the deck, she basically had to run back to the barn because he would chase her. He was furious with Andrea. He hates her. Still to this day, he cannot stand Andrea. And
nope.
So, but anyway, he'd come to the back door and he'd have his breakfast, and it's getting colder every day, and every day he'd sit at this back door, and it was snowing one day, and he was sitting out there, and he laid down at the door and he tucked his head underneath his wings and sat at the door rather than going back to the barn. And so I was done. So I went and bought a handy stitcher from Walmart, and it's like this little handheld sewing machine, and I threw together his accident prevention device, because they can't decide when they poop, right, turkeys? It just happens. So non-discriminate poopers, we call them.
Yeah, indiscriminate.
Indiscriminate poopers. Yeah, yeah. So we made him this diaper, and that was the end of it. Now he stays in the house. He sleeps in the house. He's forever in the house. And he just loves Derek and I. But anybody else, he will fight you. And he will jump at you. He will bite you. He'll chase you. He's way faster than you think,
oh, yeah.
Too. And
it's way scarier than you're anticipating, too.
Yeah.
And you might think it's the wings that are going to get you, but when he jumps and his feet come at you... The feet
like
are
eagle
what gets you. We have these pieces of plywood strategically placed between the house and the barn, and they've got holes cut in it so you can hold on to it, and it's so you can protect yourself from a bird attack.
There was a while we have this rooster named Hank, and Hank is a real menace, and then we've got Moby as well. You guys remember Moby the duck,
menace.
Also a menace, and then we have Cornelius. And so some of our volunteers sometimes, they have to go past our house, so they've got to deal with Cornelius first. And then you encounter Hank and
Moby.
Moby. We've had volunteers quit because of the birds. And they've said,
yeah, they go,
in their emails,
I had no
guys,
idea.
I did not anticipate living in fear of the birds. And so, yeah, the birds are really, really intense. But they're so funny. Cornelius blows my mind. Again, because he loves Derek and I so much. I mean, you can get on the ground and he'll come and hug us. And then he sees somebody else and he wants to tear their face off. There's so much going on in their little heads that way more than I gave them credit for. You know, even as somebody I knew, I loved animals. I loved chickens and all this stuff. I never thought that they would be... as entertaining or as engaging to watch and actually see their little cliques and how they go about their day. Like the chickens are like two little gangs and they cruise around the farm just causing trouble wherever
Street
they go.
Street toughs.
Yeah. And there is so much more going on in a bird's head or you know, a turkey or a chicken's head than I had given them credit for. So Cornelius really, really did change my impression of turkeys as well. And you know, to the they've got just as much character and personality and individuality as any of the other animals, which I did not expect.
No. Yeah, if anybody has ever called you a bird brain, take that as a compliment.
Yeah.
They are amazing creatures.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you so much, everybody, for coming tonight. Thank you so much. It's been a real pleasure.